So we are in the meantime, guys. Hey everyone, what is happening? What's up? I'm so glad to be here now. We're talking to you about something. It's one of the more complex numbers. It's always talked about how to do the something not correctly. And at first, I wanted to do a live demo, but then I realized how can I demonstrate to you something in 1 hour when it takes me 2 months, usually, to make all the weathering effects. And by the way, the name of the theme is not coincidental, how not to ruin your model. I'm talking from my own experience, because in the past, many times I ruined all of my work with a thick layer of dust and other similar effects. So here, we will be looking at some ways from real life examples, what can be achieved with mud and dust, and then I will also demonstrate on my own photos from my own models how to replicate some of these effects. So we're all set.
Yeah.
We can start.
Okay. Can we put the light on? Maybe.
Yeah. That would be good for the camera too.
Yeah, that would be really cool.
Okay, it's right there beside the door.
Oh, that's cool. Okay, then. I'll be mostly standing here, so I need to adjust my workplace. Okay, this should be okay. So, the first one is dust. And why I'm calling it weathering foundation? Because all the weathering effects, all the earth effects, they always begin with dust. The dust is the map for your further weathering, either if it's some water speckles or heavier layers of mud, like streaking effects, rain marks, anything like that. That's why I'm calling it a foundation. And now, let's take a look at some real life examples. Take a look at the photo, observe all of that. Look at the guy. He's just chilling there in the shadow. He's not caring about anything. But I will show you some specifics that I observed and how we can use them in modeling. So for example, take a look at the upper circles. You see that what the dust is doing on the antenna bases, it creates contrast between the base. And the same happens here. All these hinges for the bazooka plates, the dust collects around them, and it creates contrast between them and the main hull. And also take a look at that guy, take a look at his boots. One of his boots is dusty, the other one is not. This is the awesome thing about dust and other effects as well that I will show you. We can create contrast between parts and differentiate them. But also, look at all the texture the dust creates. It's not just a faint layer, it's actually a very thick layer with sharp edges that have random shapes. That's pretty awesome. Take a look at another example. This is a colorized photo, by the way, but it serves our purpose pretty well as well. Take a look at these examples and effects. The dust, again, it creates contrast on the exhaust. Right here, take a look at that. See the edge? The edge of the hull. It's worn down, the dust is worn down. And also take a look, it's even shiny. You can see the shine of the base color there. It defines the shape of the hull. Same here. Take a look at all the texture the dust creates on the fender. And here, we have more colors, we have darker colors. Same goes for here. The dust is one uniform color, but here and there, also here, for example, behind the spare wheel, changes now to a darker tone. And here also, take a look at how it works with the dry mud. That's another thing we'll talk about in the next chapter. So let's move on. This from the filming of the TV series The Pacific. And it also serves as a good inspiration. Because what we see is the LVT, the landing vehicle. Take a look at these effects. This is really interesting. All of the, well, in this case, it's sand mixed with water, but it can be applied to mud as well because the consistency is basically the same. Take a look at this, how it collected right here, and then it fell down on the back. Suddenly, we have something that's just clear. And here, we have dozens of very fine streaking effects. The dust and the green parts, they come in pairs. And here, the dust is completely different. It's just smooth, even layered without any texture, any defined shapes. That's also something that's really exciting. At the first glance, this doesn't look that much. It's completely meh, nothing special. But again, if you look closer, take a look at this. This is the door where the infantry dismounts the vehicle. And for some reason, the dust is rubbed off, but from the outside, not from the inside. It's like somebody was rubbing their body, you know, against the surface. So for some reason, it's there. I don't know why. I'm no expert. I'm not the infantryman. But it's there, and it's interesting. It makes the whole back blade more interesting. Same goes for here. It's an even layer, but you can see all the fine scratches in the dust layer, created probably by branches, you know, brushes, undergrowth, and it adds more texture to the otherwise bland, single-colored dust layer. And take a look at this. This is actually the part that was dusty. It was covered with dust, but then as the vehicle traversed through water, for example, it got washed off. And you can actually see the remains where the water was splashed. So that's something interesting. I didn't see that in the model done before. And why in the world the running gear is completely clean? How did that happen? I personally wouldn't do that, but this is a proof that it can happen, even though it looks like it doesn't make any sort of sense. So that's also interesting. Take a look at this Abrams. This is a pretty famous photo, you might know that, and it's full of effects. And if you notice, we're going up, we're adding more effects to the dusty surfaces. Take a look at this. Again, we have dust that's wrapped off from some of the exposed parts, like this fender, the other one as well. Here, we have some brown stains that might be lubricants, fuel, mud, anything, whatever. But compare this one and this one. The one on the other side has a sharp edge. There's no smooth transition for some reason. Probably it's fresh, so it didn't have enough time to soak up into the dust layer. And this one is very diffuse. Goes from a very dark center to a light dust layer. And don't get me even started on this one. This is just awesome. This is just such an awesome effect. It's very visible. It's dark. It's like some dark old oil that just got spilled over the tank. It looks super nice. Same with here. And again, take a look at this. For example, here, it diffuses, it feathers into the dust layer, but here, it's probably fresh, so the edge is sharp. And also, take a look at this. This identification plate is just dusty, but this one is splashed with water, and it adds texture to the whole detail, and also it differentiates that one from this one. And this is the thing we do all the time in models when we try to make two the same details different by some way. This is the perfect tool to do that. Here, yeah, this is from Syria. This is some guy. And he's doing maintenance. He's checking the oil levels on the T-72. And here also, just there's two effects, but they are very interesting. This clearly demonstrates I use this photo as my own reference many times when I'm recreating oil and lubricants that get soaked up and absorbed by dust. It's just awesome. It creates amazing contrast around the film cap or the opening, the cap is missing. And take a look at how it follows the surface. It goes like over this intake. It's like a wash, it's like a last layer of wash. Goes down here, but here it stops. Also, it copied this tie down and it ended here where the hull ends. And the fuel tank, that's pretty awesome. That's almost like a color modulation but with dust because this part is clean, almost clean. You can see a lot of the green camel color. And this one is just covered with dust. It might be camel color, like a sandy camel color, but it's from my perspective, I think this is actually a very thick concentration of dust that is grabbed off by motion of the crew or whatever. That's something very interesting. It creates a gradient between the green and the dust color. So it's almost like a color modulation with dust. So now, let's talk about the mud. And why do I say that it's not really taking the weathering game to another level? Because mud in itself, it isn't something more than dust. Like, okay, dust is just the beginner level, let's now move to some more professional stuff, which is mud. No, it's completely different thing, although it's still weathering because it's the effect of the environment, but it's a completely different effect, so yeah, that's why I don't think that mud is something more difficult than dust. Actually, I think properly done dust is much harder than mud. And what we'll be seeing here are different effects that mud can create, from just a thin layer to very thick layers. So this first one, this leopard, it's kind of, again, it's kind of uninteresting, very uninspired. Let's see. Perfect. Yeah, this is what I was going for. Awesome. Yeah, even better now. So, where was I? Yeah, this leopard, it's kind of boring, you know. Take a look at this photo, and how would you do that? I just take your airbrush and spray the whole hull with a, I don't know, deck 10 color from Tamiya or something. But again, if you look closer, and I'm always saying, if you look close enough, we will see the interesting stuff. Take a look at this. Let's start with the gun barrel. It is dusty and muddy, but if you look closer, it's covered with hundreds, maybe hundreds, I didn't count them, but many, many speckles of mud that create very gritty and textured effect. And this is something awesome to replicate on a model. Like you speckle some dust effects, blend them a little bit, let them dry, for example, for a day, then repeat to another layer, and it will achieve something nice. It will be textured and interesting. Take a look over here. This is also a case of the mud rubbing off by motion, for example, against some terrain or again undergrowth and stuff like that. So it will rub off, and it's also interesting. And the mud on the entire tank is almost completely dry, but take a look at the running gear. It's covered with damp, dark mud, which almost corresponds with the color of the dirt road underneath. And here, the back of the turret is also dirty, covered with mud, but it is a different color, it's much darker. So you can create a contrast between the turret and the hull, and also between the bars, as I demonstrated in previous pictures. And this is something that I first didn't notice when I was working on this photo for this workshop, but then I was, I might say it might not be the case, but we all know that sometimes when the mud is just so heavy and so thick, it can actually damage some metal parts, like fenders, for example. Like, for example, on your bike or on your car, you can bend the fender. And if this, I don't know if it happened this way or if it's just something else, just, you know, hinge upgrade or something, but you can even replicate the actual damage using the mud, like when the mud damaged the thin metal parts of the model. And that's also something pretty interesting to do. So let's move on to something else. This is a pretty cool photo. I mean, again, I'll show you some interesting stuff. This unloading ramp, it's covered with dark, damp mud, brought there by motion of the infantry. And this fender, this is something very interesting. Take a look at these both fenders. They're mostly dry, even here, but this part, it's covered with mud because the track, the motion of the track, throws up the mud. But just here, this side is covered, same with this one, the inner side. That's all, again, you can create so much contrast on one part with the weathering. And this is just pure awesomeness. This is just a lot of water. By the way, this is probably not mud. This is probably a dry dust all over the hull, and it just splashed with water. Because if it were mud, it would be more opaque. But this seems like it's just the dust, or even very thin mud that dried up, and it's covered with more water. And it creates a different effect. Here as well, on the road wheels, they're almost completely clean, where, yeah, they're dusty, but you can't see any texture on the inner parts. But the outer part of the diameter of the road wheel, it's compacted with thick mud, and it just goes all around the wheel, but not in the inside. And that's also something interesting which happens when the mud is very thick and gunky, like it's like paste. Same goes with this one. Take a look at the inner part of the track. We, what we do all the time in our models is that when the weathering is finished, we take a graphite stick or a pencil or something, or some commercial product, I don't know, and we polish the inner parts of the tracks. We do it all the time, it looks nice. But for real life models, they show us it doesn't happen all the time, because again, when the mud is so thick and it sticks to everything, it'll create that effect. And it's also something challenging to make it look like it's intentional and not like you forgot to polish the track. That might be something interesting to replicate. Now, what I most of the time what I do is that I call it pre-dusting, which is, I also have my own mixture of that. It's just some Tamiya paints. You can mix your own mixtures according to the battlefield or the terrain you're replicating, but this is like a mixture of flat earth and deck tan, something like that. And it's thinned down very much, because if you're not careful enough, you can ruin a lot of work with this pre-dusting. Because you just airbrush a thick layer of paint over all your chipping and fine brush work, and then you hate yourself. What you did. That's why I call it how not to ruin your model. So this is usually the first step, and I sort of just create a roadmap that I would follow with more precise techniques. Second important thing is rain marks. Again, I make my own mixture most of the time. Again, it's from Tamiya paints. But what is very important when you're making this mixture, don't forget to add some sort of liquid soap or something like that into the water, because otherwise the surface tension of the water will force the pigment in the Tamiya paints to break up. It will create these ugly small clumps of pigment, and it will be completely useless, because it will be just water with some clumps of pigment floating in it. It won't be useful at all. So the liquid, for example, soap or dish soap cleaner, it helps to rectify this problem. You can even see in the bottle that it creates small bubbles. It's very bubbly, the mixture. And what I do with this, I brush it on the model, in this case, from up, down, following the gravity. And one thing that's very different from, for example, creating dust with enamels is that when you're using enamels or oil paints, for example, what you do, you brush them on, let them dry for a few minutes, then you blend them. You correct any mistakes you did, and you just create the final effect. In this case, there's no blending involved. What you brush on stays on the model. That's why the mixture needs to be super thin, and you need to apply it slowly and in layers. Like this effect you see here, this is like 10 layers of the mixture. Brush over the roadmap that I brushed before. And I think, if I do say so myself, the effect was just amazing. I liked it so much. That's why I do it all the time this way. And then, on the horizontal surfaces, I use like a tapping motion. I just create some cloudy patterns with the dust. Again, I follow the roadmap with the pre-dusting. And again, the effect looks quite convincing. On its own, like if I were making a dusty model, I could literally leave it like this. It will look okay on its own. And what if we have slightly angled surfaces? You know, if the angle is super slack, what I'm going to do then? I mix both ways of application. I do some tapping motion and some dragging, like rain marks. I follow the gravity again. It will create an effect similar to this. So that's something like in-between effect. Then I started doing the actual mud work. And what I did here, because this was a very critical step, I could ruin the model again with it. So what I did first, I had some reference photos from World War II, and I just followed them very carefully. So what I did first was that I started with in places where I was sure were completely covered with mud. In this case, the part right under the track. So that was the start. Then I expanded the effect with a bit lower, but now I had to work very quickly before the mud paste dried up. I prepared some of this. I don't know how you guys call it. I call it a sea ball, because it's just a ball you find at the sea, on the beach. And it's very useful for recreating all the grass and all the natural debris in the mud that collects in the mud. So I did this in advance, and while the mud was still wet, I just pressed it into it, let it dry. And I also combined some static grass, but not the type of it that comes in a package and just sprinkle it over the base, but these small turfs, you know, that they have glue at the bottom. You just pick them up, and I put them there, and they stay like that. Okay? Then I moved on with more mud. So I went down, and before the paste dried up, this is by the way acrylic paste, so you can thin it down with water, which is super convenient. Before the mud base started drying, I blended the edges with water and a paintbrush, so the effect looks much more natural. And this is very important when it comes to this. I even create mud streaking with the paste. I paint some streaks and I blend the edges, feather them into the surface. But still, this is just a foundation for the following effects, because now even the color somehow looks good enough to represent mud. I covered it all up with a brown mud color. This is the alkaline from water, super useful color. It smells like chocolate ice cream. That's intentional, by the way. So this is acrylic paint, and I covered it all up until it looked something like this. I know, it looks awful, but it's the way it is. It needs to be done like this, because right afterwards, again, using water, I blended it, and it actually started looking much more natural now. Here's the original look. Here's the blended effect. So this was, remember, with the Tamiya paints, I created dust layers, which is the foundation for the weathering. Now I'm creating dried up mud. Heavy mud that got dried up and in turn, you know, light color. Again, it's another foundation for further effects that we will layer on top of it. Which are, oh, not yet. Okay, so here I'm adjusting and tweaking here and there some of the effects with enamel color, because it doesn't react with the acrylic, so I can move fast. I did all of this in one evening. I'm just speckling some of the color in the transitions between the dirty parts and the clean parts to give it more texture to the look, so to say. And then if I applied some accidentally, like here or here, I just blended them with enamel thinner and they were gone. So no problem there. And as well, at this step, I created some footprints. This, by the way, this is the silicone boot print from Caliber 35, which is almost a vintage item by now, because they don't exist anymore. And I mean, I used the same enamel color, and I just pressed them on the surface like this, and then boom, this is the effect. But what is amazing about using enamel colors is that if you make some mistake, like there's too much color on the boot and it creates a very ugly effect, and it spills over the surface, you can just let it dry for a few minutes and then blend it away with a fine paintbrush and some thinner, and the effect is going to be very crisp and detailed. Now I made the dark mud mixture. Unfortunately, I don't have a photo of the mixture here, but in the next article there will be. But this is essentially just a dark brown enamel mixture of damp mud, which is not glossy, but it's darker. And I'm just applying it here and blending it. The glossy part is that's thinner, so I'm blending it. So again, I started moving from the most dirty part that I know and I knew will be completely covered in heavy mud layer. And then I expanded downward. And again, I used my previous work with the dry mud streaking as a roadmap for me, as a guide. Where should I put all those dark streaking effects? Well, I just had to follow all the dried up streaking effect that I did before. And it creates very, very cool little effect when the outside, like here, when the outside is dry and just the center is dark, muddy color. Then, to make it look like a tank passing through Alden Forest, I used 1.5 package of laser cut leaves. Too many of them, but I had to do it to make them natural. I just put all these leaves in the places where they would naturally collect, so behind the tracks, on the tracks as well. And yeah, like this. I just placed them with tweezers, then I fixed them in place with the AK gravel and sand fixer, which works really well even for this. I just soaked them up completely, let it dry, and they hold very strong on the surface then. To blend them more with the mud, I gave them very thick muddy wash, the same color I used on the actual mud, to make them look more natural. Just because you like here, it's dried up, so the leaf is still visible, but it's dirty, it looks much more natural than if you would, like, if you left it just like that, just like clean leaf, look much more unnatural. Now, we are going to one of the final steps, is creating wet, glossy mud. And I just use this murky water, which is nothing else than just gloss varnish, enamel gloss varnish. And I paint this into the centers of the most dark areas, like on the road wheels, some go here, you know, and then blend it again with thinner. It will create such a very smooth, feathered effect that looks super nice. And yeah, tracks. Usually I darken them with one of the many solutions on the market because the color and all the like the mud paste and stuff like that, it holds much better on this kind of oxidized surface because it has texture that holds all the effects in place and it doesn't chip down, so it doesn't expose the actual color of the track, which is bright silver. In this case, I started with two different colors, just sort of, I was just experimenting what would become of them, so, but the most prevalent was a dark brown, because I just like the color, I just like the shape of that. I let it dry, then I covered it with enamel color, which represents dust, and dry mud as well, and this is, by the way, this is the case of creating dust with enamels. Now I'm not using Tamiya paints, so this is a different way of application, different technique. So what I'm doing, what I did first was cover all of it with the mud effect. Then again I feathered the edges, you can see here. It's still wet from the thinner, so it's a little glossy. So like this. Now I moved onto the upper surfaces. And you can see here that I have foreseen some effects that we are going to do later. So for example here, there was some cap, I think it was a lubricant for the suspension, something like that. And in many photos we can see the stuff spilling out of there, streaking down. So I applied some darker color, which is this one, brown dirt effect. I also mixed them together here and there to get some variation between the colors. And note that the turret isn't weathered yet, that's just a clean with chipping and all of that, so the dust is just on the hull. That's to demonstrate the contrast between the two. Now I'm usually using pigment, which is very unusual for me because I hate pigments personally. But in this case, I'm using them in a very controlled manner. You can see the minimal amounts. I'm using different colors to enrich the effect. You see, I'm just blending them, and when the thinner evaporates, they distribute like a wash because they will collect here in all the crevices, and it looks pretty nice. And also, it gives the dust a very heavily matte surface and very minute, fine texture as well, which looks very natural, just like the real thing. Now here I am. What I'm doing? Yeah, Yeah, I'm speckling some of the mud on the back to make it look again more gritty, more textured. And you might note one thing. The amount of mud in this photo, in the previous photo, is much smaller than on the finished model. And that's because at first I was very careful with it, but then I just realized, oh, when the model was almost finished, that it doesn't look okay. It isn't what I see in the photo. So I just repeated all the steps, just in these two areas, and added more. But I didn't document that because the steps are the same, just the amount is different, and you will see that. So now I just speckled some more of the effect to make a very textured transition between the muddy parts and the mostly clean parts. Next, again, my trusty mixture, but in this case I also use murky water, which is a glossy effect, into the mixture. And what it does, hopefully I will be able to show you. I brushed it on the lower hull, and again, in a very random manner. I blended it, again, no flooding of the surface, just feathering the edges. And what it does, the murky water in the mixture, that after the blending part is done, some of the places where the concentration of the color is the heaviest, they will be slightly shiny, glossy. So we will have matte and glossy surfaces already. So it's much more interesting. And it also affects the color of the mud. It's more saturated that way. I don't know why, again, I'm no scientist, but it's just the way it is. Here, I'm adding some streaking effects. Again, I just painted all this underside of the track goes, and I'm just painting streaking effects from that and blending them. Also, you might think, and it's true, that this is completely pointless, because none of this will be visible on the finished model. So why I'm doing it, and why you should do it? I have two reasons myself. First one is practice. Practice, practice, practice. It always makes you better. If you fail, nothing happens, it probably won't be visible at all. Yeah, but you get more familiar with the mediums, with the products, and with the techniques. The second reason why I do it all the time. What if the camera somehow goes behind the road wheels and it will show everyone that there is nothing? And what if someone spots it on a modeling show, for example? I would be just embarrassed, like, why did that happen? That's just laziness, you know? But so that's why I do it all the time, even on models where all the effects are going to be completely invisible. I'm doing the same thing here on the rear parts, also check this out. I'm sort of, again, making more contrast in the crevices. Again, blend it the same way. Also, look at this. There's a hinge on the rear plate, making a wash around it. Now, I'm using just the murky water, but I'm thinning it down a little bit to make it easier to work with and to apply it. And yeah, also note that I applied some speckling with the mixture, so it's more random. And now I'm using the murky water again to paint the centers of each streak on most of the heaviest concentrations of the dark mud, like the underside of the fender and stuff like that. And again, this is practice, and it looks good if you take a photograph and show it to your friends or whatever. But also, it makes you better each time you do it. And stakes aren't so high if you fail, because it will be hidden behind the running gear. And by the way, also, you need to do all of these techniques on the road wheels themselves, so it will be visible there. Don't worry. Here I'm using the murky water on each segment of the fender, again, to create contrast between each of them. So I'm just brushing it on like that, and then feathering the edge again with some thinner and a paintbrush. But I'm not flooding the surface, I'm not touching this part, just here, just the edge. And here I'm also using some speckling. You can see I have a pretty shitty brush for this, very stiff bristle brush. And I just speculate all over these big flat surfaces that have no surface detail at all, just to make it more gritty and textured, you know, more interesting to look at. And if I make some mistakes, which happen because this is just a completely random effect, I just very quickly take a paintbrush and some thinner and just wipe them away. Nothing bad will happen. And yeah, so this is the actual result when I went back, I added more of the textured earth effect, again covered it with enamel dust, then some speckling, and same dark mud mixture and glossy effect. So it was all the same, just more. That's why I didn't really capture the process. I just went back and added more. So this is the finished result on the G34. And you can also see, for example, here, there's probably grease or diesel or whatever spilling out of there, and it creates more of an orange effect, orange-ish effect. It happens in real life as well. It looks super cool. Many people, for some reason, confuse that with rust, but it's not. It just has the same, very similar color. And like on the previous real life photos I showed you, again, some spill grease is here. It's creating contrast between the main plate and the armored cover of whatever there is underneath. And here this, by the way, almost we are at the end of the demonstration. I have here just some more examples of my work, how you can use these techniques to create different effects on different vehicles. So this is a World War I vehicle. They were very slow, and the battlefield was always very muddy and like knees deep mud in World War I. So you can, again, this is a different subject, different laws apply to these types of subjects. The techniques were the same, but the result is a little bit different. Same goes for this mouse, which I have here. Take a look at the dust effect, the streaking dust here. They add more texture to the plane turret side, you know? Also the crewman as well, there's some dust on his knees, on his boots, and on all of these engine panels there's also forced contrast using dust and all the greasy and wet effects. Like for example, here is just dry dust. This is much cleaner and also differentiated with spilled grease. So it creates more contrast, especially when the vehicle is completely matte, like this factory primer mouse. Also here on the cast pamphlet, it's very matte. You have some interesting small stains of water or grease or whatever. Same on this IS-7. I created many random streaking effects with the murky water, and I used a lot of speckling here to add more texture to the piece. Again, it creates interesting effects when used in conjunction with the enamel. Tamiya paints and some pigments, because the Tamiya paints, they absorb the enamel gloss and it turns them darker. It doesn't happen with enamel paints. This happens only with Tamiya paints. They absorb the enamel gloss and it makes them disappear. Just like the pigments, for example, but this is much more durable. And I think this is the last one. This is a Russian BMW 3. You can see, again, a lot of contrast using dust. This upper bolted-on panel is covered with light dust. And here is much darker effect, like a dead mud, you know, like here as well. There are some clumps of earth collected here, and don't get me even started on all these blocks. They are all differentiated with the same effect, like even here. This is just a faint layer of dust. This one is much more heavy and more textured. Yeah, so yeah, that's actually it. So if you have any questions, I'm gonna turn on the lights if I don't trip over anything.